Hi, I'm Colin Riley, an engineer within the game engineering organization of AMD. I work with game developers, helping them get the most out of our gaming products, such as Radeon graphics processors. In this short presentation, I'll be introducing two DirectX 12 Ultimate features, which are available in our new RDNA 2 graphics architecture, sampler feedback and mesh shaders. I'll also explain some performance recommendations for both. Sampler feedback is enabled by new hardware functionality which allows graphics developers to infer information about what texture data is read by a sample operation. There are two formats of feedback map available. MinMip lets you know which is the highest MIP level requested, and MIP region used records all requested MIP levels. The resources are stored at a lower resolution than the texture being sampled and works at a user-specified tile granularity. The feedback is written into an opaque feedback resource directly in the HLSL code and requires a decode operation be performed on it before it's read for further use. This is an example of how samples from a texture with four MIP levels can be represented as a min-MIP feedback resource. The red areas of the MIP levels indicate reads during the samples. Here you can see that only MIPs 1, 2, and 3 are required, and the largest MIP 0 was not read. This feature can prove useful in implementing texture streaming systems or when designing texture-based shading techniques. Due to the interaction of MIP maps and various filtering modes, emulating this in the past has proven difficult and could lead to visual artifacts, so having real information here is very useful. For RDNA 2 on PC, our performance recommendation is to avoid writing feedback for every shaded pixel. You don't usually need that granularity of information, and it can bottleneck the GPU on writes to the feedback resource. Instead, you can write your feedback pass to skip pixels randomly by discarding them in the pixel shader. We've seen high rates of stochastic discard resulting in higher performance with little to no image quality changes. You can experiment and find a level which works well for your needs. The next feature we'll talk about is mesh shaders. Mesh shaders are a new feature which gives the greater control of the geometry pipeline. There are two new shader stages to achieve this, and the primary focus is that smaller batches of geometry are processed in parallel. Traditionally, geometry has been processed as large in-order buffers of index and vertex data. This rigid structure depends on fixed function blocks, limited data types, and requires developers to pre-process input geometry in various ways through memory and compute to cull effectively for the best performance. Mesh shaders, along with the optional amplification stage prior to it, introduce a compute-style API to meet the needs of developers, whilst allowing parallel hardware to be more effectively used. The only input is via the user-defined graphics root signature, with threads interacting using group-shared memory. Mesh shaders output small, indexed primitive lists. With the API based around compute, mesh shader thread groups work together in order to write elements within output arrays. These output arrays contain indexed lists which feed primitive assembly and the rasterizer hardware, and are known as meshlets. This gives graphics programmers new flexibility to manipulate data which feeds the GPU. Meshlets can be thought of as small submeshes from an original larger mesh. These are fixed in size so that a single mesh shader thread group can output exactly one meshlet. With this in mind, meshlets should ideally be built as part of the asset bake process, with processing for as much local vertex reuse as possible. You can organize the meshlets in memory whatever way you'd like, and associate further data like bounding boxes with the meshlet descriptors for use in culling, or level of detail information to influence decisions made in the amplification stage. Mesh shader pipelines are used with a new API function, dispatch mesh. Like compute's dispatch, it takes thread group counts as parameters. If an amplification shader is provided to the current pipeline, multiple amplification shader thread groups are launched, each working together to write a payload which is then accessible by the mesh shader thread groups it launches. Culling can be done here and mesh thread groups not dispatched, or amplification of geometry, like in legacy tessellation pipelines. The payload in its simplest form could be a collection of meshlet IDs which are then to be read for processing by the mesh shader. The mesh shaders also work together, this time calculating vertices and primitive information before writing them into the shared output arrays. The contents of the output arrays define the meshlets which go into rasterization and launch pixel shaders afterwards. Attributes are also written into the output arrays as defined in the HLSL and are accessible in the pixel shader. The newer mesh shader pipeline is simplified significantly when compared to the previous vertex shader pipeline with hull, domain, and geometry stages, but it's very powerful. Mesh shader pipelines provide the ability to use custom data types, such as reading compressed geometry formats directly, custom culling without additional compute passes, better vertex reuse, and more flexibility. It also allows for amplification of meshes, like tessellation, and can also be used to implement geometry shader style workloads. Whilst this allows for new ways of handling vertex processing for developers to experiment with, the barrier of entry for this feature can be quite high. Due to the changes of geometry baking required to create good meshlet collections, it touches upon many aspects of the design of a game engine. Good processing of geometry to create meshlets can take some time to tune for best results. With RDNA 2 on PC, we have some performance recommendations for those who are wanting to use mesh shaders. A recommended primitive and vertex count for meshlets is between 64 and 128. You should try and restrict writes to the shared output arrays such that each thread only writes to its own thread ID location within those arrays. Do not write multiple vertices or at offset locations. With the previous recommendation in mind, match the number of threads to the maximum size of your meshlets. If you fix your meshlets to have a maximum of either 128 vertices or triangles, set the thread group size to 128. This spreads the computation wide on the GPU to better utilize the hardware. And to hide latency when launching mesh thread groups from the amplification stage, dispatch at least 4 mesh thread groups, outputting a minimum of 64 primitives at a time. Do coarse culling, instancing, and level of detail calculations in the amplification stage. Don't perform per triangle culling in the mesh shader, as the overhead of the additional computation in the mesh shader can often negate the benefit. However, if culling primitives in the mesh shader is essential, utilize the SV cull primitive attribute. This can be much faster than writing degenerate triangles. And be wary of using bit masks on group shared memory for visibility testing and culling in the amplification shader, as it can open you up to LDS bank conflicts which can lower performance. Whilst the pixel shader stage of a mesh shader pipeline is optional, be aware that using amplification and mesh shaders as a means for GPU work creation by writing UEVs may not be the most efficient means of achieving this. Ordering guarantees can end up holding back waves, and you may have better performance using other compute shaders. If you have a geometry shader pass in your engine, try porting them to mesh shaders. This is a low-hanging fruit introduction to mesh shaders, which can provide better performance than geometry shader pipelines. And lastly, profile your mesh shader implementations to ensure they perform better than any legacy stages they are replacing. There will still be areas where traditional pipelines will win out in performance. So that's a quick insight into two new DirectX 12 Ultimate features and the performance recommendations for RDNA 2. We can't wait to see what you create with this new functionality. Please reach out to your AMD technical contacts for further assistance if required, or tweet us at GPU Open. Thanks for listening.